Maud Martha by Gwendolyn Brooks. Maud Martha is both the title and the heroine of Pulitzer Prize winning poet Gwendolyn Brooks' memorable work of fiction. The book is actually a novella composed of vignettes or sketches of Maud Martha, her family and friends, and the marriage she enters into as a young woman. Maud grows up in the Chicago of the 1940s. In the story you are about to read, Maud's family awaits the return of the family patriarch, who has gone to town to apply for a loan so that the family will not have to give up their home. What had been wanted was this always to last, the talking softly on this porch with the snake plant and the jardiniere in the southwest corner, and the obstinate slip from Aunt Eppie's magnificent fern at the left of the friendly door. Mama, Maud Martha, and Helen rocked slowly in their rocking chairs and looked at the late afternoon night on the lawn and at the empathic iron of the fence and at the poplar tree. At the poplar tree. These things might soon be theirs no longer. Those shafts and pools of light, the tree, the graceful iron, might soon be viewed possessively by different eyes. Papa was to have gone that afternoon, during his lunch hour, to the office of the homeowner's loan. If he had not succeeded in getting another extension, they would be leaving this house in which they had lived for more than 14 years. There was little hope. The homeowner's loan was hard. They sat making their plans. Well, we'll be moving into a nice flat somewhere, said Mama. Somewhere on South Park or Michigan or in Washington Park Court. Those flats, as the girls and Mama knew well, were burdens on wages twice the size of Papa's. This was not mentioned now. They're much prettier than this old house, said Helen. I have friends I'd just as soon not bring here. And I have other friends that I wouldn't come down this far for anything unless they were in a taxi. Yesterday, Maud Martha would have attacked her. Tomorrow, she might. Today, she said nothing. She merely gazed at a little hopping robin in the tree, her tree, and tried to keep the fronts of her eyes dry. Well, I don't know, said Mama, turning her hands over and over, that I've been getting tireder and tireder of doing that firing. From October to April, there's firing to be done. But lately, we've been helping Harry and I. And Maud Martha. And sometimes in March and April, and in October, and even in November, we could build a little fire in the fireplace. Sometimes the weather was just right for that. She knew from the way they looked at her that this had been a mistake. They did not want to cry. But she felt that the little line of white, sometimes rigid with smoked purple, and all that cream shot saffron would never drift across any western sky except that in back of this house. The rain would drum with a sweet The rain would drum with as sweet a dullness nowhere but here. The birds on South Park were mechanical birds, no better than the poor caught canaries in those rich women's sun parlors. "It's just going to kill Papa," burst out Ma Martha. "He loves this house. He lives for this house." "He lives for us," said Helen. "It's us he loves. He wouldn't want the house except for us." "And he'll have us," added Mama, "wherever." "You know," Helen said, "if you want to know the truth, this is a relief. If this hadn't come up, we would have gone on, just dragged on, hanging out here forever." "It might," allowed Mama, "but an act of God may just have reached down and picked up the reins." "Yes," Maud Martha cracked in, "that's what you always say, that God knows best." Her mother looked at her quickly, decided the statement was not suspect, looked away. Helen saw Papa coming. "There's Papa," said Helen. They could not tell a thing from the way Papa was walking. It was the same dear little stacco walk, on one shoulder down, then the other, then repeat and repeat. They watched his progress. He passed the Kennedys, he passed the vacant lot, he passed Mrs. Blakemore's. They wanted to hurl themselves over the fence into the street and shake the truth out of his collar. He opened the gate, and still his stride told them nothing. "Hello," he said. Mama got up and followed him through the front door. The girls knew better than to go in, too. Presently, Mama's head emerged. Her eyes were lamps turned on. "It's all right," she exclaimed. "He got it. It's all over. Everything is all right." The door slammed shut. Mama's footsteps hurried away. "I think," said Helen, "I think I'll give a party. I haven't given a party since I was 11. I'd like some of our friends to just casually see that we're homeowners."